So stop me if you heard it before. You're browsing eBay when you find a strange item. You take a closer look at the photos and you find yourself having more questions than not. The mystery gnaws in your brain and you realize the only way you're going to get an answer to those newfound questions is if you click that mystical buy it now button. That's the short version of how far too many things have ended up in my collection. It's also how I ended up with this weird piece of strangeness, the IBM Personal Computer Graphical File System. The name alone made me curious, but what really caught my eye was this little panel on the back saying that you need one of a small list of compilers. It was at this point I realized that what I was holding was a big box software development library from 1984. For those not familiar with software development, libraries are bundles of code that provide pre-built functionality. For example, a popular library in the current day is the Simple Direct Media Layer, or SDL, library, which has been used to help develop numerous games over the years. Given the name Graphical File System, I had initially assumed that it had something to do with browsing files. Frankly though, after reading the box's descriptions, I was at a total loss. The little blurb at the front of the box was especially useless in this regard. It's an ANSI Metafiles standard for storage and transfer of professional quality graphics on a file-oriented storage system. The Graphical File System provides highly portable graphical information and easy-to-use icon interfaces to enhance programming productivity. To put it bluntly, that was a perfectly good waste of an explanation. Grammatical issues aside, I legitimately have no idea what this does, aside from the fact that it has something to do with graphics and files. As it turns out, I would end up falling down a deep rabbit hole trying to solve this mystery. As usual, this is your host, NCommander, and today we're going to unbox something strange from 1984. With that said, take it away, pass me. Let's crack the shrink wrap. It's already kind of going, so let's first time this has been opened since 1984. Inside, we have a binder, the hefty install manual, and the five and a quarter inch discs. Okay. All right. Let's see if these are readable. With the unboxing complete, it was time to break out the SuperCard Pro. Interestingly, only three of the discs were labeled as part of the Graphical File System. The other two were labeled Professional Graphics Series Device Drivers. As the discs were being dumped, I spent time flipping through the rather hefty manual trying to figure out what I had just unboxed. Now, I've worked with tech for a long time, and the large slab of documentation was rather remarkable for one reason. Throughout the hundreds of pages in this binder, I could not find a single simple description of what the Graphical File System actually is. In fact, I've read tax code documents clearer than this. Instead, the vast majority of the manual talks about the larger professional graphics series and something called metafiles. From what I could piece together from both the manual and the internet, metafiles were part of a larger specification known as the Graphical Kernel System, meant to standardize how computer graphics were done as a whole. Historically, computer graphics were implemented through proprietary systems with little to no standardization. For example, Apple had created QuickDraw for their early GUI efforts on both the Lisa and the Macintosh. Meanwhile, Microsoft had standardized on their own GDI interface for Windows 1.0 and later. The same problem also extended to printing, and specifically how graphics could be sent to a printer. Just like display and rendering, graphical printing was dominated by multiple proprietary solutions, most prevalently by Adobe's PostScript. The folks behind the Graphical Kernel System specification had decided to solve this problem through a system of abstractions which they called the Virtual Device Interface, or VDI. VDI defined a series of commands that defined how graphics should be drawn. These commands could be rendered on screen or they could be sent to a printer. The best way to imagine this is to think on how you may draw this capital N. you might use a list of commands like the one on screen. If we step through each command step by step, you might see how a computer might draw it. For instance, we may draw two rectangles and then the diagonal lines that connect them. Afterwards, we just need to fill in the connected areas and boom, a giant N. Of course, being able to send drawing commands is only one part of a larger challenge. For the purposes of interoperability and compatibility, it's extremely important to have a defined format for loading and saving a set of these drawing commands. That is where the virtual device metafile format comes into play. Metafiles provide a portable exchange of graphical information to and from a disk. From what I can tell, the metafile format was at least partially adopted in industry. For example, the popular for the era drawing program Harvard Graphics is able to both import and export to and from the metafile format. With this newfound information, would it be safe to assume that the graphical file system was a way to create and work with these metafiles and embed them into programs? Well, if we wanted to know for sure, we were going to have to set up a development environment. After dumping the last disk, I used hxseed to check the validity of my dumps. To my relief, all five disks were in good condition with valid bitstreams and no copy protection. All I had to do at that point was convert them to raw images. Afterwards, we get our first look at the files contained within. The first three disks, which were marked Graphical File System, had what you might expect from a software library. There was a collection of test applications, library files, and sample sources in C, Fortran, and BASIC. Meanwhile, the two driver disks have VDI drivers for a variety of IBM graphics adapters, printers, and more. From the manual, these are meant to be loaded from config.sys to provide the virtual device interface as a system service. Surprisingly, there's support for quite a bit more here than I expected. Besides EGA cards, there are also various drivers for monochrome displays, as well as special support for the PC Junior's 16 color mode. This was something of a surprise because the box itself said that only IBM's original color graphics adapter and the very high-end professional graphics controller were supported. Still, I'm not complaining since EGA cards are easy to emulate. With the disks ready to go, I fired up a new virtual machine with an EGA card and installed PC DOS 3.3 and then copied the files over. Since I expected to do some programming, I also installed Borland Brief as a good text editor. After fiddling with config.sys and autoexec.bat, I think we're good to go. At this point, I can run the grid test application, which shows that everything is working properly. In fact, this is a good opportunity to demonstrate the device independence of VDI. By changing the emulated graphics card, we can see how grid rendering changes. In each case, the image displays to the best of its ability despite the differences in both hardware and capability. It's also at this point that you may notice that the EGA versions of grid do not look quite right. Rather notably, the image resolution looks off. I'm not certain if this is a problem with grid, the VDI driver, or perhaps PCM's EGA emulation. I don't have a physical EGA card to test with, so I can't say for certain what's going on. Rather notably though, I did get a system hang with a monochrome EGA driver. If you've got a physical EGA card and want to try this, get in touch so we can definitively rule this out. Beyond that, I'm going to continue with the emulated card for now, but I may come back to this subject if new information comes to light. With VDI mostly working, we can now load what the manual calls the interactive interface. After displaying its splash screen, we have what appears to be a drawing program of some sort, but looks are deceptive. First off, there's no mouse support, so moving the cursor is done by pressing the arrow keys. Secondly, there isn't any actual drawing to be done here. There's a set of buttons on the right, but the main purpose of this program is to render stored metafiles. We can do this by placing a rectangle representing a given file on screen and then entering its file name and the picture ID number. Multiple images can be placed down and even overlapped. That's really all there is to say about the so-called interactive interface. Using Harvard Graphics, I exported a few example metafiles so we can see all the fancy drawing. While it's a neat demonstration, I couldn't help but feel a little underwhelmed. As far as I could tell, the only thing you can accomplish here is to send rendered metafiles to a supported printer or plotter. At this point, I assumed that all the meat and potatoes were hidden within the programming library itself. Of the three supported programming languages, I was most comfortable in C, so I went to install Lattice C, and oh boy, I didn't expect the world of pain I was about to launch into. Lattice C is rather notable because Microsoft licensed and rebranded under its own name. In fact, early Microsoft compilers were just Lattice C with different branding. That being said, I quickly realized that actually using Lattice C was in fact an experience and not what I call a good one. To start off with, the archive documentation appears to be incomplete. There is absolutely no word here on how to install Lattice C. After considerable trial and error, I found that installation is in fact handled by a batch file that has absolutely no error checking. If that makes you think that I might have blown up my file system not once, but multiple times, you'd be absolutely right. The trick, for reference, is to run a/make-lc while in the root directory of the C drive. If done correctly, this creates the directory structure properly and then installs the files without doing something idiotic. It's at this point I ran into even more problems, primarily because it seems that DOS 3.3 is too new for Lattice C. The first problem I ran into is that Lattice C does not ship with a linker. Instead, it expects the system to have one. Early versions of DOS up until 3.2 actually shipped with link.exe as part of DOS, which is at least understandable. Rather conveniently, the graphical file system also contains an updated link executable on the driver disks. The fun doesn't end here. Lattice C gives very terse and confusing error messages, and I went around in circles figuring out why I couldn't get Hello World to compile. Eventually, I did realize that there are special batch files that have the correct options and switches to get things working. After that, I did manage to compile Hello World, but that wasn't an end to my suffering. It all kind of goes downhill from here. The next step would be building the sample code that shipped with the graphical file system. Helpfully, the GFS manual does list the commands necessary to do this. The only problem, though, is that the commands in the manual didn't work. It's at this point that I realized that the graphical file system was ran for Lattice C 2.0 and I was using 2.1. Still, I would think that this is close enough, right? Well, the answer is yes, but it took a lot of fiddling to derive the correct settings. Even when I got things building, I still can't say for sure if it's working properly. For one, I had to make some changes to the code because it was running through a timing loop too fast. Secondly, the example code doesn't seem to render properly. This could be related to the EGA issues we had earlier, but the showMetaC example renders differently than the grid example. Looking at the two side by side, the image appears squished and the font is different. Things get more confusing if I try a CGA card. Under CGA, the image is squished to the left side of the screen and the color palette has gone completely bonkers. However, as unlikely as it seems, both these behaviors may be expected. There is a specific function call in the documentation to set rendering coordinates which is not used within the example code. Furthermore, the appendix for the CGA graphics driver has a section about setting the palette, although there is no apparent function to actually do so. I have to assume that the grid test application does things that the example code does not. For the sake of comparison, I did actually compile the Fortran version of the example code, and it shows the same behavior as the C version. Still, glitches aside, I did get this all mostly working, so maybe now is a good time to show some awesome demos involving metafiles. Well, that was the plan, but at this point I began to realize that there was something missing. If I turn to the index of functions provided by the graphical file system, there is a total of 15 functions which all relate to the displaying of metafiles. There's nothing here relating to creating or manipulating graphics. Heck, aside from the special VDI driver that can print to a file, there isn't even a way to create a metafile. In fact, the vast majority of the manual beyond this point is just a technical reference for the binary metafile format. For example, there's no way I could create something like the interactive interpreter. I'll remind everyone that the box itself said that the graphical file system provides highly portable graphics information and easy-to-use icon interface to enhance programming productivity. While I can technically display graphics from a highly portable format, there is no way I could make an icon interface since I could not implement something like a mouse cursor. I spent a lot of time researching this in an attempt to understand what I was missing. Eventually, I did manage to put all the pieces of this puzzle in context, but to do so, I need to go back to the professional graphics series that the manual mentioned. IBM had fairly large plans for making the PC a low-cost system for doing computer-aided design or CAD work. The pinnacle of this was the Professional Graphics Controller, a monster of an ISO card with an integrated 8088 processor designed to provide accelerated graphics rendering. Released in 1984, the PGC provided a 640 by 480 display with 256 colors in an era where 4-color CGA graphics were still common. From what I can tell from the surviving PCG documentation, it essentially operated on VDI drawing commands on a one-to-one basis. It seems that IBM's Professional Graphics series was entirely intended to support the Professional Graphics Controller, and it may put things in context if I read the list of known software that was under this label. In short, there was the IBM PC Graphical Kernel System, the Plotting System Library, the Graphical Terminal Emulator, and finally, the Graphical File System. If you're confused, well, that's really understandable, since as it turns out, IBM had made their own implementation of the Graphical Kernel System standard and then sold it under the same name. As you might imagine, this made searching for information a real joy. On top of that, it's the kernel system that has nearly all the drawing and interfaced functionality. What I have is actually an add-on library for the IBM GKS. While the graphical file system is technically usable in and of itself, it's obvious that it's just one bit of a larger whole. More simply put, I have a programming library add-on for another programming library that was ultimately intended for use with an obscure piece of IBM hardware. I am legitimately surprised that this ever got sold in a box. The Professional Graphics Controller was not what I call a mass market item, and I only knew of its existence due to a fluke. If you watch vintage tech videos, there's a good chance you've seen LGR's video on unboxing and setting up his IBM PC-8T. At one point, he flips through the manual, and this right here is how I learned that the Professional Graphics Controller even exists. You really can't make this up! With that little story aside, I will say that it's not very surprising that the Professional Graphics Controller is so obscure even within vintage tech circles. From what I can find, there was very little software that supported it, and I got the feeling that neither the controller nor the Professional Graphics series as a whole were what we could call successes for IBM. Still, successes or not, both the controller and the Professional Graphics series are neat pieces of IBM history to say for sure. Maybe someday I'll be able to demo the controller, but for now, we'll have to settle for EGA graphics. It's at this point that I'm pretty sure that all of you are expecting me to install the graphical kernel system so I could use my obscure add-on to do something fancy, and normally, you'd be completely right. The one problem is that the graphical kernel system hadn't been dumped by the time I started work on this video. I'm going to draw emphasis to the word hadn't here. Originally, the script for this video contained an entire section talking about how things like this never get preserved, but it appears that fate has intervened. In late November, a copy of all three volumes of the Graphical Kernel System surfaced at the Computer Reset Warehouse. When I saw this, I was able to get in contact with the finder and made sure it got preserved. This alone is a major win for software preservation, and I'm very grateful for those who have made it possible. Anyway, with that, it's time to close, but before I do so, I need to ask for a bit of help from all of you. While I currently have all the equipment to save and preserve disk images, I am somewhat less equipped to deal with manuals. In the case of the graphical file system and other similar products, the manuals are just as important in the disk dumps, and they're good to have regardless. I don't have a flatbed scanner, and even if I did, the GKS manual was over 400 pages long. In the end, I ended up using this Neat Receipts portable scanner to scan each page one by one, but it was very slow and tedious to do so. It did work, but the end results were not what I call ideal, and the colors ended a little washed out. I have quite a few manuals that need to be scanned, so if you can help, please get in touch. I'm especially interested in hearing from people that may live in the New York City or Northern New Jersey area. With that being said, I do hope you enjoyed this video, and as usual, you can follow my adventures in real time on social media. As always, this is your host, NCommander, signing out and hoping you all have a wonderful day. Bye bye!